Well, good afternoon, everyone. I hope you enjoyed lunch. It smelled delicious. looked delicious. I hope you enjoyed it. Good afternoon. My name is Dr. Matthew Costello, and I serve as the Vice President of the David M. Rubenstein National Center for White House History and Senior Historian for the White House Historical Association. It is a pleasure to be here with you all today, and I'm very excited for this panel. We have a great collection of talent, expertise, knowledge to approach this topic, and I'm very excited to share the stage with three of you. But before we get into that, I would be remiss if I didn't at least add a little fun historical anecdote to the session. So I found this one, and I thought it was pretty amusing. Maybe you'll agree, maybe you won't. On November 6th, 1947, President Harry Truman held a press conference in the Oval Office. You know, in between questions that were revolving around grain exchanges, there was inflation, price controls, and also the Marshall Plan, one reporter piped up, "Mr. President, have you seen any good movies lately?" Truman answered, "Well, I never get a chance to see a movie unless they bring one to the White House. And about the only thing I see are newsreels. I try to go when I am not in them." So I guess that was funnier in 1947 than it was today. Truman's quip touches on one subject that we will discuss today with our panelists. Presidents in newsreels in real life are very different from the presidents portrayed on television and in film. These cultural mediums reach and educate countless Americans, people around the world, about the office of the presidency. This inevitably leads to the questions of accuracy, authenticity, as well as how defined should these boundaries be between history and entertainment. Joining us for this conversation today, we have Lilly Goren, Professor of Political Science and Global Studies at Carroll University, Gloria Reuben, acclaimed actress, author, and Tammy Haddad of Haddad Media. So to get us started, you can read more about these exceptional individuals in our program. We have the full bios, but I did want to start by having them each talk a little bit about their backgrounds, their expertise, and the perspectives that they're going to bring today. So why don't we start, and we'll just move down the line.
Lilly? Okay. I'm Lilly Goren, and I teach political science and political theory and gender and politics at Carroll University, which is in Waukesha, Wisconsin. And I have spent a lot of time in terms of my own scholarship and research as a sort of trained political theorist looking at texts to understand what texts teach us about our understanding of politics, society, culture, gender. And so I started off doing this with regard to a guy named Shakespeare, who was a popular culture writer at the time. And I have sort of evolved my scholarship in terms of paying close attention to popular culture narratives, particularly in television and film, where I am looking at a lot of the time the same way that one would look at a Shakespeare play, what the text is teaching us, what do we understand about ourselves, our politics, society, gender, from those popular culture texts.
I'm Gloria Reuben. As Matthew mentioned, I'm an actress and a singer and an author. Many of you might know me from a television show called ER. That's not why. Thank
still
you, but
love it.
I know that you're surprised that I still look the same. But I'm here today to talk about my portrayal of Elizabeth Keckley in the film Lincoln. And we did have a screening at the White House when President Obama was in the White House, and Daniel Day-Lewis portrayed Lincoln. Tony Kushner wrote the script, the screenplay, and Steven Spielberg directed the film, so as you can imagine with that trifecta, and Sally Field was Mrs. Lincoln, so all of us involved, deep historical dives, everything is authentic, because that's the only way that Daniel and Tony and Stephen would have it, myself included, not like I had a say, I'm just, but very much looking forward to telling you a little bit more about the amazing Elizabeth Keckley.
Hi everyone, I'm Tammy Haddad. I am a longtime political producer. I worked at every cable channel you've ever seen, producing Larry King Live, Fox News Sunday, Today Show, MSNBC, you name it. And then on the side, I started getting calls to consult on films and TV series about presidents and politics. And maybe you've heard of some of the shows, Veep, the film All the Way, Confirmation. And I was actually just on Capitol Hill with a former director for an upcoming Netflix show. I'm so glad to be with all of you. Don't you love this place? Isn't it great? Thank you, Matthew.
Well, I'm glad that you all could be here today. You certainly know more about this than I do, and that's why I am the moderator. So I'm looking forward to you enlightening all of us on your different experiences. And I'd like to start first, Gloria. You mentioned your role portraying Elizabeth Keckley for the acclaimed film Lincoln. And I'm going to pull up the image here. Can you start by telling us more about who Elizabeth was, how this role came about, and how you prepared for it?
Well, I haven't seen that image in a long time. Talk about authenticity. Literally, Elizabeth Keckley was invited by the Lincolns to go to the opera, and that shot was taken from that scene. Her life really was extraordinary. She was born into slavery. Her biological father was the master of the house. I'm clearly giving you a broad overview. Many things happened between these markers, if you will. When she was a teenager, maybe 13 or 14, she was given as a wedding gift to her half-brother, one of the legitimate children. So for he and his wife, they left Virginia, went to North Carolina. While Elizabeth was a slave to her brother, she was, unfortunately, very much unfortunately, raped by a neighbor. And she gave birth to her one and only child named George. Cut to a number of years later, Elizabeth and George are now in St. Louis. And Elizabeth is a slave to another legitimate child. By this time, Elizabeth is not just supporting her half-sister and that whole family, because unfortunately her half-sister's husband is not very good with finances, et cetera, et cetera. But Elizabeth has, she has garnered an extraordinary list of clients, not just because of her incredible talent, but also because of who she was as a person, her whole energy. She was extremely graceful and she was equanimous all the time. She was very respectful. She dressed in her own designs, always looked beautiful. She always held her head high, even though she had been through extreme trauma for pretty much her whole life. Eventually, Elizabeth, really for herself, but especially for her son, is diligent in becoming free. She needs to be free. She wants her son to be free. She goes to her sister and asks her sister for freedom. And her sister says, yes, if you pay me $1,200. Now, Elizabeth's one of her main clients, hears of this situation, and Elizabeth is so well respected in that community that this one client asks other clients, these are all high society women, politicians, wives, to raise money for Elizabeth so she can buy her and her son's freedom. They do so. Elizabeth pays back the women who would like their money back, but the ones who gifted the money, she's very grateful to do so. Her son by that time goes to Wilberforce University in Ohio. Elizabeth Keckley moves to Washington, D.C., opens up her own business here in Washington, D.C., not that far from here, 1017 12th Street Northwest. And one of her clients, immediately because of her letters of recommendation from St. Louis, garners another group of high society politicians, wives, as clients. And one of them says to Elizabeth, I would like to set up an appointment with you and the soon-to-be new First Lady. Elizabeth Keckley meets Mary Lincoln the morning of the first inauguration, March 4th, 1861. The next day, Elizabeth Keckley is hired by Mary Lincoln to be her personal modiste, and Elizabeth ends up being her confidant. Now, during this time, very soon after the president is sworn in, very soon after the Lincolns are in the White House, in February of 1862, Willie Lincoln dies of typhoid. Mary Lincoln is bereft, of course. It is the second son of the Lincolns who has died. Elizabeth Keckley is very much a part of the Lincoln White House. Obviously, the Civil War is happening at this time. Mary Lincoln has always been a highly emotional, a little volatile, and President Lincoln, of course, is very busy trying to deal with this Civil War, and Elizabeth becomes almost, again, that confidant, that close with the Lincolns, both President and Mary Lincoln, and with their sons. But at that time, it's Elizabeth Keckley who consoles Mary Lincoln, and this is what bonds them in their friendship that went on for not just the time that the Lincolns were in the White House, but beyond. Elizabeth Keckley is the one who prepares the little boy for the funeral. She's the one in the room when President Lincoln, this is all fact, President Lincoln walks in and says goodbye to his dead son. 6 months prior to this, Elizabeth's only son, George, who could pass as white, signed up to fight for the Union in the Civil War. It was pre-Emancipation Proclamation. So legally, he wasn't because he was mixed race, he was a black man, but he signed up because he wanted to fight for the Union. That's how much he believed in freedom. He died in his first battle, was buried in a mass grave. Elizabeth was never able to mourn his son. That preparing little Willie Lincoln was the connection that she made with Mary Lincoln. They grieved their sons together. And that was the bond that created this friendship that, please God help me, that I'm making into a film, Elizabeth Keckley and Mary Lincoln. There's a book that I have the rights to, Jennifer Fleischner wrote, one of the many books that I did research on. Mrs. Lincoln and Mrs. Keckley, the unlikely friendship of the first lady and a former slave. Now, when I got the call to audition for this role, and I'm embarrassed to say I didn't know anything about Elizabeth Keckley. I had a day and a half to prepare. Steven Spielberg wants me to go on tape with him. I'm like, okay. Daniel Day-Lewis, no pressure. And, you know, a day and a half, great, no problem. So, I Google everything that I can. And as soon as I read that one page of Wikipedia, emotionally I connected to this woman. I don't need to go into detail, but I just connected to her fortitude and her faith and her overcoming trauma and all of it, consistently looking forward, standing up for things that need to be stood up for. And so I go on tape a day and a half later. In the scene, it was clear that Tony Kushner wrote this particular scene because it was masterful. It wasn't one of the scenes that ended up in the film. However, this scene is with Elizabeth Keckley and Mary Lincoln. And it's almost like a monologue because Elizabeth is talking about her life. And in the scene, it's written that Elizabeth is sewing. And this is kind of audition 101. You never bring props. You never bring props. But I brought props. I just felt like I needed to have my hands busy. And I'm paraphrasing what was on this page. I brought a silk scarf or something and a needle that was already threaded because there was no way I was going to try to thread the needle. So that was ready to, I'm very prepared in these things. And so I'm, you know, talking to Mary. Again, I'm paraphrasing, but I wanted to have my hands to do something because my son George, he died last year. He fought for the Union. He was a beautiful boy. I got the part. So after, thank you. My research included many things. I went to where I read up on, I planned, and I went on and documented my research road trip on Elizabeth Keckley. I went to the places that were still standing, where she lived, where from Virginia to, from North Carolina to Virginia. A couple of the places are now historical sites because of Elizabeth Keckley. The one thing that I am, the first place I went was here, and I'll never forget it, 1017 12th Street Northwest. Brownstone, where she lived and worked. I'm walking down, I'm turning the corner, it's all corporate buildings. I'm like, oh, well, you know, maybe it's one of these corporate buildings. Nope, the brownstone is still standing to this day. I took photos of it. It was for sale at the time. There were lawyers' offices in there, what have you. I called the realtor. I'm like, man, I got some chutzpah. I called the realtor. I'm doing a little research on someone who used to live here. Super vague. This is 2011. I was just wondering, you know, maybe someone can let me use. And he gave me the code to get into the building. I'm not going to tell you who the realtor was. And I went in, I walked through those floors where Elizabeth Keckley lived and worked. The whole place needed to be redone. You could see the brick, the original brick through the wall. It was one of the most profound things. Walking through that brownstone, walking on the ground where Elizabeth Keckley walked, walking through the White House, when we had that screening with President Obama, I'm not joking, it was a profound spiritual experience, I kid you not. I was meant to do this role, and again, I have three projects that I want to do before my end of days. I'm not sounding macabre, but I just hope. And this story of Elizabeth Keckley and Mary Todd Lincoln is a story that needs to be told. It's not about slavery, it's about freedom and faith and fortitude and strength. And so that's all I got.
Well, thank you so much for sharing that and also giving us sort of I don't know about you guys, but I felt like it was kind of like we were watching the movie in real time.
Yeah.
Incredible. Tammy, let's move over to you because you have a different experience, right? You mentioned working as an executive producer, being involved in so many different projects. The one that I wanted to focus on more was the HBO film All the Way. So can you tell us a little bit more about that project? What was the process like? And how, in your experience, how did this compare to other films or other projects that you've worked on?
Well, Bryan Cranston, I mean, come on. He was unbelievable. Did anyone see the play? I hadn't seen the play on Broadway. You guys saw it? So unbelievable. So the idea of putting it on film after it had this long, incredible history, I just felt so lucky to be connected. So what I did was take the director, Jay Roach, great Jay Roach, and his production designers, and took them to all the rooms. So on Capitol Hill, his original LBJ's original office there. We went down on the House floor, and it's funny because the person that took us around, he's since left, told us this story about how they used to vote. You know, now there's little buttons. You guys have probably been there, but you used to walk down, and they would tap, and then put up, you would vote and drop it in. And you know, there's nothing, just to Gloria's point, the more real it is, the more successful. It's gotta be true. That's how life is, that's how it is in film. And the time that these film directors and producers and stars spend looking into it and really taking the time to, you know, catch the feeling of it, and even in, you know, being in the Cannon building. And I brought them over to the White House, to the vice president's office. And again, you guys probably know this, the vice president's office in the old executive office building, you know, you open the drawer and all the vice presidents have signed it. So we did that, and you could see, you know, how moved they were. And then we went to the vice president's balcony that looks out on the mansion, right? Looks out on the actual White House, the White House. And you could just feel the history all around you. So that's the key thing. The other thing we would do is we brought them together with some of the people, and there weren't that many, that had worked in the LBJ administration. And just to hear them talk about what they were like and the family's legacy, there was a little bit of a conversation about the family legacy. And it's funny, when we finally did the premiere here in DC, we did it over at the archives. And they pulled out the Bill of Rights. You know, like you can't step away from the importance of the history and understanding this country, how people live, who these people were, and what they had to face. What you're talking about, I mean, I saw the film. Honestly, that's incredible. You gotta make that movie. Who would watch that? I would watch that, right? Like, we're all gonna
100%.
Watch it. Well, wait, but Matthew, that's why it's critical what you're doing, and it's why it's so good everyone's here, because you've got to know. And I work on the comedy side too. I worked on Veep and these other shows, and comedy, it's even more important, I would argue, that it's funnier when it's completely true, period. Right? And Eric Lesser, you guys heard Eric speak, right? Oh, there's Eric right there. That when we worked on Veep, they send the scripts and you look at it. And you know, you have this whole thing, Matthew, because like you're dealing with big people, like I'm dealing with Jay Roach. Oh, I'm going to tell him to, you know, move the camera here. Or I'm going to tell these Veep writers to go do this or that. And you really have to think about, I mean, and then we would always just say, well, this is how it actually is. You guys decide how you want to show it.
Mm-hmm. Now, I should mention that even though our panel focuses more on film, all of our panelists also have experience working in producing and researching television programs as well. Gloria, you were also cast as Valerie Jarrett, yeah, who served as the senior advisor to President Barack Obama in the Showtime series, The First Lady. Can you tell us a little bit more about that role and the fact that, you know, we have these two different roles, you know, it's television versus film.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about that because you've done both. Does that change your preparation or process for preparing?
Well, not so much. I mean, yeah, it's the wig. It's that,
like, I wasn't going to say anything, but yeah.
She just says, I love that. It was so much fun. Valerie, Ms. Jarrett, I don't know. I call her Val. I don't know why. I just couldn't help my, right? But it is, as you know, it's a different way of going about work because of the schedule on television. And, mm-hmm, you know, you only have so much time and you got a lot of work to do and not a lot of time. So there's that. But also, it is a little bit more pressure to play someone who's still walking the earth, mm-hmm, you know, because you just want to get
They're
it right.
They're out there.
Yes, exactly. But I loved, of course, you know, how important Val, Ms. Jarrett, was for the Obamas, obviously, since Chicago days, and the kind of relationships she did have with, she does have with Michelle and the former president. Of course, the relationships are still extremely strong. She's now CEO of the Obama Foundation. Mm-hmm. But there was, you know, it was a very intense time in the way that, because it again, the limited time frame makes, I'm very sensitive to energy. It's like it gets a little bit more frenetic, mm-hmm, and which is fine for the role because that was what was going on at the time. Everything was frenetic, and you know, the process for me is always the same. I dive as deep as I can. I was only in a few episodes, but that doesn't matter. You know, it doesn't matter about the amount. It just matters the quality of the content, I think. So, you know, I read her autobiography. Of course, there's tons of stuff you can watch. Mm-hmm. Obviously very different from Elizabeth Keckley. Mm-hmm. So I just love, but there's just something about her. Mm-hmm. Do you know, you just can't help yourself. You gotta kind of love her because she's got all this energy and there's just goodness beaming out of her everywhere.
And power.
And
she's
power.
The most powerful woman that's ever been in a White House.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well, Matthew, you're the historian.
Okay.
Back me up here, Matthew.
Wait, let me finish.
Duke it out.
So, but you know, the monochromatic suits, that power suits, and the, you know, all solid, just like, exactly. The glasses that match the suit. She's just like a spitfire in every possible way, smart as a whip, and could handle those, like, I don't know if I can
you
say,
can say
you know,
anything here.
A man, like the former Chicago former mayor, like whatever. Like she had to deal with these, predominantly these men that were
very tough.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I'm trying to help. I don't think I am.
I got this.
Aggressive.
No, I'm just kidding.
You were
very aggressive. So, but it really was a great. It's a shame that Showtime didn't pick up that series for another year. How many years?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The First Ladies that they could have dove into, but not my.
Lilly, I want to turn to you now because you, professor of political science.
I'm a bit of a rinker on this panel.
Well, I didn't say that, but what are you doing here? No, I'm kidding. You take a very different approach to these things, but we're talking about television and film and people who have portrayed the president and how the president is portrayed and what are our expectations of what a president is or should look like or act. And so I want you to tell our audience a little bit more about how race and gender shape our pop culture presidencies. And I know you have a few
slides.
So here, why don't you go ahead and take that?
Okay.
I think you just hit the green arrow.
Green arrow.
There you go.
There we go. Morgan Freeman. This is a movie called Deep Impact from 1988. And a lot of this research comes out of this book, which is a decade old, called Women in the White House, Gender, Popular Culture, and Presidential Politics from the University Press of Kentucky. No shameless advertising here.
Who wrote that?
I'm one of the editors of it with Justin Vaughn. In any event, I was writing a paper in 2007. Obama was camped out in Iowa. Hillary Clinton was ratcheting up. Clearly, she was running for president. And I sort of was curious because I'd done all this work on sort of television and gender roles and representation. I was curious about the portrayal of the president by men of color, perhaps, and also by women. I was really looking at who would get the nomination based on what I saw in popular culture. Was it more likely to be Barack Obama, or was it more likely to be Hillary Clinton on the Democratic side in 2008? And I remembered when Morgan Freeman played the president in this movie about an asteroid hitting the Earth in 1998 called Deep Impact, and he was the president of the United States, as you see him there. And there was another movie that came out about a week after it, so they had both been greenlit at the same time in Hollywood, called Armageddon, and Billy Bob Thornton played the president in that. So you have asteroids hitting the Earth as the narrative, and in one movie you have a black president, in one movie you have a traditional white president, and I will go through the list of many of the white presidents that we are know and love or despise, and there was no controversy about the fact that Morgan Freeman was playing the president. Granted, he had already played God, so this was like a step down, maybe. But there was a lot of controversy about the fact that like two exactly the same narratives that had huge budgets were made by two different studios and came out within weeks of each other. That was the controversy, not the fact that you had a African-American actor playing the president, which at that point, 1998, you did not see that much of. And so as I started to do this research, I went back and looked at the sort of deep impact issue. And you know, again, you can talk about this question of representation because we're all used to seeing people like Martin Sheen, Michael Douglas, Alan Alda, Harrison Ford, Kiefer Sutherland, Bill Pullman, James Cromwell, who's played the president twice, and also Prince Philip once. He seems to be like the archetype for male leaders of some kind. And Billy Bob Thornton, who's also played it twice. That's usually the folks who get cast either in television or film as presidents. And so I was sort of looking at, you know, we have this example, as I said, of Morgan Freeman, and then I was looking a little bit forward, and at that point, in 2007, we'd had Dennis Haysbert and D.B. Woodside on the television show 24 as presidents. You also had Chris Rock as president in the movie Head of State. Terry Crews in Idiocracy. And also you had, at that point, you had seen Jimmy Smits in The West Wing that we had already talked about. There's an evolving sort of category or grouping I saw of black men or men of color who were sort of getting into the narrative. And so I was looking at that, and as I was looking at that, I went a little bit backwards, of course, as one does with historians. There's a film from 1933 that also features a black president, but really the first one in the contemporary period is this movie called The Man that stars James Earl Jones. It was made in 1972. It's almost impossible to watch. I found that when I was doing this research. It was very, very difficult to find a copy of this film to actually watch it, and I asked my friends at the Library of Congress to dig it up for me. It's written by Rod Sterling. And it's essentially about this backbench senator who also is a college professor, who the president dies, Speaker of the House dies, the vice president's sick, becomes president of the United States accidentally, because all these other people sort of get out of the way, and he's kind of this backbench senator who happens to be the president pro tem of the Senate. So here we have a film, 1972, where the president is a black man accidentally in the office. And I started to sort of look at the narratives around the people who were being presented as president, aside from the white guys. And what I found was you have this move with regard to featuring black men or men of color as president who accidentally get into the job. It's a long period of time where I'm watching this sort of evolve over movies and film, like Chris Rock in Head of State. Then you start evolving into the president, if there was a president of color who actually gets elected, like Dennis Haysbert's David Palmer on 24. And so I'm noting this sort of narrative trajectory. First, there's an accidental black president or president of color. Then they're actually elected in the narrative as fictional individuals. And so then I start looking at the female presidents. And if you haven't seen Kisses for My President, which came out in 1964, I might suggest you might want to see it, perhaps. Because it's really about Fred McMurray, who becomes the first husband when his wife gets elected president. And she doesn't get elected accidentally. She actually comes into the office. But in 1964, apparently you can't be president and be pregnant together. So at the end of the film, when it turns out she's pregnant, she resigns from the White House. That's why I said you might want to watch it, or you might not. It's a little kind of backwards forwards problem there.
Is that how they thought the first gentleman would dress?
I guess so. Scenario? Yeah, exactly.
That's the question, yeah.
And all of the female characters in this movie also have very androgynous names. It's very interesting. And we also see this as I sort of start to look at what's in front of me at this point in the late 1990s and into the 2000s, as we've seen in television, and you start to see, again, if there's a female president, like Gina Davis in Commander-in-Chief, which we also talked about this morning, she gets there accidentally. If we look at Battlestar Galactica, where you have a female president, she gets there accidentally. In fact, she's 42nd in line in Battlestar Galactica. It is, you know, again, it's sci-fi, but whatever. And then, of course, you have Glenn Close in Air Force One, where she doesn't actually become president. She's the vice president. She never signs the papers to become president when Harrison Ford is on the plane with the terrorists. And then you have Joan Allen in The Contender, where she also, you sort of anticipate that she's going to become president, but you don't actually see it. And so what I started to see is that there was this pattern. It was really fascinating. The pattern became clear to me that African-American men and men of color had become president accidentally, and then they evolved into getting elected in fiction. Women, same story. They had been moved into that office accidentally, and then the same way they became essentially elected, as we've also seen in some subsequent television and film. Cherry Jones becomes president in 24 and is elected into that office. But again, what was interesting to me was the fact that the female characters, this narrative was much more telescoped than it was for the black or people of color men. And ultimately, when I concluded my research in 2007, I said, the likelihood is Barack Obama gets the nomination and gets elected president. Political scientists don't really like to be prognosticators. We leave that to pundits. But I sort of thought I was onto something there. And so my research was really sort of looking at not only the representation issue, because we've seen more people who don't look like Alan Alda or Martin Sheen in fiction, which also helps us, if you're watching the show, imagine somebody who doesn't look like the 44 people who have been in that office before, the 45 people who have been in that office before. Imagine what they would look like if they looked different. And we become more used to and possibly more accepting of somebody who doesn't look like the 45 white guys who have actually been in that office, because we've imagined it. We've been on these narrative rides with people who are president of the United States in fiction, And we can sort of think about that idea and give it some air and space to breathe, which I think is one of the ways that Barack Obama was able to sort of present himself as sort of part of that narrative in the early or the late aughts.
That is, I mean,
kisses from my president.
That image will
haunt you.
Haunt me.
Yeah.
Yes.
Incredible.
Well, thank you for sharing that overview of your research. One thing I was thinking about when you were talking is, you know, of course, this is cyclical, right? Because we're going to continue to have elections.
Sure.
And, you know, do you care to take a wager or a guess on sort of what we could see on the horizon in terms of, are we going to see a change in who could be in that type of office? I mean, aside from, you know, who are the leading candidates currently, but, I mean, do you see us at another inflection point where perhaps we can learn more from pop culture presidencies about sort of forecasting the next, I don't know, 4 years, 8 years, 12 years?
Well, I mean, I think it is art and life go back and forth with one another, as we were talking about in the earlier panel on television. And the fact that we have an elected vice president who happens to be a woman and happens to be a person of color suggests that some of the sort of groundwork was laid in certain ways by having that become a little bit more normalized. We saw Sarah Palin run for president, for vice president in 2008. We've seen, in fact, women running for president more frequently now, and also individuals of color, both men and women, running for president more than we had sort of not only previous to Obama, but to some degree previous to having the idea of who occupies that space, that you know, sort of iconic space in our imagined minds, who can be in that space and have it be kind of more normalized.
Mm-hmm. May I say something?
Go ahead.
I was going to run for president, but I was born in Canada, so I can't.
Oh.
Even though I'm a dual citizen. But even more than that, I swear way too much. I curse all the time. I would never last a day.
Well, maybe you can run for Congress instead.
Oh, yeah, that goes.
This is a question for all the panelists, and feel free to respond to the question or to one another's responses. But one thing I was struck by is how we, as moviegoers, have changed our consumption habits for film. With the rise of multiple streaming services, more and more people are watching movies at home versus going to a movie theater, a trend that was accelerated by the pandemic. So how do you foresee this impacting the film industry and the types of movies or shows that will be produced? And how could that impact, I mean, there's a lot here. How could that impact portrayals of the presidency? So I guess getting into more of the dynamics of earlier we talked about studios, what they decide to make, how much should it reflect reality or not reflect reality, and how is the movie-going experience now that it is changing, how will that impact the types of shows or movies we see?
I'd love to. I know we were talking about this earlier, if I may jump in here. Because of COVID, obviously, everybody's changed their habits of movie viewing and streaming television shows. As some of you may know, there's a writer's strike on right now for this very issue. It has changed the landscape financially for writers, actors as well. You know, there are a handful of the mega streamers, we all know who they are, who are making. Production values are huge, they're making a lot of money, but it's not trickling down. Now on that front, actual movie theaters are, you know, they're still around, some didn't make it, but there is that love of going to the movies. Mm-hmm. Personally, I think as someone who has been in this business for a very long time, there are a couple of things at play. Economic disparity happens all the time in movies and television. You may not think it does, but it happens all the time. There's that. Secondly, the, you know, movie, I think people love, everybody's going to always love going to the movies. Now, that streaming is here to stay. There's that, obviously, for sure. Mm-hmm. Personally, I think that if a film opens up in the theaters first for maybe 3 months or something, and then it's available on one of those major streamers, awesome, because then the audience gets a choice of either going to the movies, having that communal experience, and it stays with me. You can't pause it and, you know, whatever. You're there, and you have to be committed to the story. I love that. It stays with you longer than streaming. Mm-hmm. Mind you, streaming has its benefits as well. Right. Now, when it comes to, there's a new television show, speaking of streaming, I hope I can, it's called The Diplomat.
Yeah,
it stars Carrie Russell. Now, you talked about that earlier?
Yeah.
It's a, talking about, you know, talk, it's a great series. She's amazing. She's been always incredible. At the end of, I'm not going to say what happens, but there is this, you know, this possibility of becoming president. I'm not going to say how that happened. Do you know what I mean? So, to your question about how is media changing, I'm curious to see the second season, how that does progress, if it does. But movies are here to stay. Support your movie theaters, please. And, you know, continue to enjoy streaming. We can have the best of both, but it's important to support the actual movie cinemas.
And pay the writers and pay the actors.
Yes.
It's so funny you should bring it up. We were talking about it a little bit before. I don't know if anyone's seen the first episode of White House Plumbers on HBO. It's about, come on, guys. It was Sunday night. Well, see it when you get home. It was on Sunday night. It's Woody Harrelson, Justin Theroux. It's the story of Watergate, the Watergate plumbers. So it's funny, Matthew, because it's always a surprise to me, even though I'm in the D.C. forever, how much people are interested in Washington. So these are some of the Veep writers, Dave Mandel, great producer, Curb Your Enthusiasm, Veep. And they have this story. I mean, Watergate, you got 15 books about Watergate here, right? Like there's so many books, but they found the story that had never been told about the plumbers who actually had broken into the offices 4 times. They were arrested, and the whole story in Nixon's fault was because of the plumbers, right? But no one actually focused on it. So all these years later, and just to your point about your story, there's so many stories to tell. The thing that I worry about is, for example, plumbers is 6 or 7 episodes, limited series, you guys know the language. There aren't that many TV films anymore, like LBJ as a film. I don't know that, I mean, I would think HBO would make it today, but that you have to do it in a series because you have to amortize your costs, right? So it changes the production. But the interest, and I watched The Diplomat last night, the interest in political shows, in presidents, in a people of power, that interest is still there. People are more, I think, and again, I'm a cable news producer too, are more interested in Washington. They see how what happens at the White House affects them directly. Mm. It's not separate. Right? And if you think of the pillars of leadership, and by the way, the pillars of democracy, you're talking about government, you're talking about media, right? This past weekend was the White House Correspondents' Weekend, and Bradley Whitford was here, of course, in West Wing, many other shows said, people are still lined up to talk to him because they felt something about it. It's just like you mesmerized all of us. The feeling that you get when you're watching these shows together and you connect and hear these stories, that's what's still so important. So I agree with you about going to theater. I'm worried about people not going to the theaters. But I think that there's still a lot of power and it's increasing because people want to know, like, what's it like behind the scenes? I think. Mm-hmm. Watch Plumbers tonight. Justin Theroux grew up in Washington, I'll just say. Justin Theroux grew up in Washington, was never at the White House. You know, like for many of us that have access to come here, Woody Harrelson, well, he was in Game Change. But like, people do not have this kind of access or to hear these stories. And they find it really compelling. You know, even if you have this amazing career, right, to learn about how things happen.
Yeah, I would just add in terms of what Gloria was also saying in the ideas of the narrative evolving and we saw this in Madam Secretary where Elizabeth McCoy becomes president in the last season of that show. We've seen it with regard to Veep, obviously, and so you do have these narratives that also can expand, and that's one of the issues, the differences when I talk about this in sort of an academic way, that you tell a 3-hour story or a 2-hour story in a film, but you can tell a 13-hour story in a series. Mm. And sometimes they have maybe a couple episodes too many.
That's all in the setup to the ending.
I know. Night Agent could have been 3 episodes less.
By the way, is that a true? I never heard of Night Agent.
No.
Okay, totally. Do you guys see that on Amazon? It's really good.
Yeah, very good.
And I never heard the language Night Agent with the White House. It's like a guy that's there answering the phone at night.
Oh, I should watch.
That's the crisis guy. Yeah, it's actually really good. They're doing a second season.
But I do think that there are different narratives that get told in different spaces. And so absolutely going to the movies, because it is also an encapsulated story. Mm. Whereas, you know, we were talking about the fact, like, would there be a reunion of the West Wing earlier this morning? Mm-hmm. And, you know, the West Wing went on for 7 seasons. They were 23, 24 episode seasons. You got to know all the characters really well. And that's a different experience in terms of following the narrative, where you're watching it. Maybe you get up and go and get something to drink and come back. Whereas if you're in the movie theater, you are there and you're in it. And I think that's emotionally different. And that sort of pushes on different parts of our understanding of these cultural artifacts as well.
Yeah, it's interesting because I feel like there's so many ways to get distracted, right? Mm-hmm. If you're watching something at home, there's always phones and iPads and children, all kinds of things running around.
And,
but you know, if you're in a movie theater, you know, you are focused on that screen.
You know, it's funny you should bring up the two screens, because Scandal, you know, another political show, was the first show that played 2 screens, that all the actors were tweeting. I don't know if you guys were in all that. And they were the first ones. They were also, I'd like to point out jealously, they were the first ones that showed the Truman balcony. Because Shonda Rhimes got President Obama to take her up there, and they shot that, and that thing was exactly the way the Truman Balcony is, never in another show. Mm. Not to geek out on you. But, I mean, come on. Yeah, let's go there.
I didn't know that. Yeah,
let's
totally.
Well, I think we can all agree that we certainly need a movie or a series on Elizabeth Keckley.
Yeah. Yes, definitely.
And 100%.
That's for sure.
We get that as a movie, and then we all go to the movie theater together and we go see it.
Yes,
so,
I think that's right.
We do have some time for audience Q&A. Anyone? We have one in the back over here.
Thank you. I don't know if you stand or, but my question is about portrayal of atrocities. Steven Spielberg, for instance, has done a lot of movies where he talks about the Holocaust and how it changes the messaging for the masses in supporting things like the U.S. Commission on the Holocaust or just different things. When it comes to slavery and presidents, that message does not get through, which is the reason why, as an activist, when we talk about slavery and the need for a proposed U.S. Commission on Slavery, we're not able to get it through because popular culture doesn't present it in that way. Or do you feel that when there is too much of a friendship, it makes it seem like it just wasn't there the way it was there? For instance, between Mary Lincoln and I forgot her name, and Elizabeth. Thank you. I don't know if my question is making sense.
I'm a little confused of your question. Are you asking if the friendship between Elizabeth Keckley and Mary Lincoln diffused the issue of racism?
Not racism, specifically
of
slavery.
Of slavery, I meant.
Yes, and also the other part of the question is, when atrocities around the world is portrayed in popular culture in a way that the masses, you know, Americans, that we can feel the pain, we can understand, and we can support policies about that. And I give the example of the Holocaust. When it comes to slavery, we're not getting that same sense. And I wonder if the panelists can help me answer.
I totally understand. I understand what you're saying. I think that there are 2 separate things here for me to comment on in terms of the atrocity, clearly, of slavery. There are some extraordinary films that are very factual and extremely disturbing and unforgettable. When it comes to slavery in times of certain presidents during those years, I don't know of any, but I don't know every single film that was ever made. I don't know kind of how it would obviously depend on how one goes about telling that story, because it has to be. I would think that we pretty much know the broad strokes, if you will. So how do you bring it into the personal story of one particular president who is dealing with something specific about? I don't know if I'm making much sense, but if you can kind of narrow it down to the individual stories, then that can be a compelling thing. The broad strokes of it are a little bit more, I would think, I'm not a filmmaker, but I would think might be a little bit more challenging to write and to portray. But I've never thought about it in depth. Perhaps there is something, an opportunity there. And when it comes to Elizabeth Keckley and Mary Lincoln and Elizabeth Keckley in the White House, obviously during that time, of course, again, the Emancipation Proclamation happened during the Lincoln presidency, as did the passing of the 13th Amendment. And in Lincoln, that scene with Elizabeth Keckley and Mary Lincoln in the House of Representatives actually happened. Elizabeth Keckley was there. So in this story, there is, again, it's Elizabeth Keckley's life, but obviously those two extremely vital instances will be a part of the storytelling. This is not a biopic on Elizabeth Keckley, a time frame between her meeting Mary Lincoln the first morning of the first inauguration and after the president is assassinated. Take note as well, part of the story I'm going to be presenting in this film is the influx of a numerous, slaves were being freed in certain states before the, right? There was an influx of freed slaves, newly freed slaves, or those who escaped in Washington, D.C. And Elizabeth Keckley actually started a foundation, a nonprofit, to help these newly freed slaves, Contraband Association. And she, one of these things that I see in my head is her walking. She would go through these, literally, they were tent camps, and talk to some of these freed slaves. And this is documented. This is part of what she, and their response was varied from, I want to go back because I had a roof over my head and food, to I'm so glad I'm free, to the country owes me everything now. Right? So that scope, and that's going to be part of the story as well. Those are very specific but very important things, Emancipation Proclamation, 13th Amendment, and what was happening in the free, newly freed slaves, what they were thinking during that time. I don't know if that answers your questions, but I hope it's helpful. Stories are always, there's always a story to be told, but it has to be a specific, it has to be the personal story, how it's connected to the bigger issue. That's what lands, that's what keeps in people's minds, I think.
In the front.
We have been greatly, benefited from this beautiful session. And all the panelists, as they have mentioned and talked about their perspective about the film and the president. I'm Pakistani American. I came to see the realization of American president's dream and everything, but at this time, what I see, how the films are bringing the perspective of our founding fathers. Sometimes I really feel that it's not the same, because when I moved to America 35 years back, I had the great images of those great people, the presidents. And I want to see in the film the same thing, because if we like to build up our character according to the founding spirit of America, then we have to see that how film is serving to America. Because when we go outside America, people ask, what is America? What are the presidents of America? Because social media definitely have brought so many things, but so many distorted things. It's not something that is a true story of America. True story of America we can learn from a great perspective of founding fathers. And I believe that you people are doing a great job. Specifically, when I was hearing you, you are bringing your, not only your words, your true perspective, and thank you very much for your hard work. And I wish to congratulate the White House Historical Association as well, you know. Thank you very much. You. This is Dr. Zulfikar Kazmi, and I'm also serving one Pakistan's television, first tourism, national tourism channel. It's a Discover Pakistan, and I'm the president of Discover Pakistan.
Thank you for your comment and your attendance. Oh, another question?
We have one over here.
Hi.
We'll do this one next.
I'm Dr. John Willen. I happen to be, I'm the vice president, one of the vice presidents of the Lincoln Group of D.C., and I wanted to compliment you on your portrayal of Elizabeth Keckley and the fact that Verena Davis tried to get her to go to Richmond to be her dressmaker, and thank goodness she didn't do that. But and the other thing is, I'm an infectious disease specialist, and I wanted to compliment you on your portrayal of Jeannie Bollet in ER, and when I think back to it, to way we were dealing when that started, we didn't even have effective treatment for HIV, and people should go back and watch that if they haven't seen it, because they really handled HIV really well.
Thank you.
Over here.
This is primarily directed to Gloria Reuben. You had mentioned something that I think was very important, and I hope that you can expound a little bit more about it, about the economic disparity among the viewers of television and in movies. Some of the most quality things are on these premium cable channels, which are out of my budget range. And I have to wait until several months later in order to view them on Netflix. But hello, after September, I don't think I could do that anymore. Because the discs won't be available, but So why are so many of these pitched to the more expensive premium television channels rather than maybe PBS?
Well, I don't know. I mean, that's not. I was kind of referencing the when we were talking about the writer's strike, the disparity in producers and who. But your point is well taken, because when I think about a number of these, again, these kind of mega corporations that are the top five or six, if you will, of these. I don't need to know, you know, of these streaming and their membership and what the that money goes to certain people, and you know they're not sharing the wealth, and it does. It can, it's not like network television where everybody can tune in on ER 40 million, like that doesn't happen anymore because of the access. And it is a valid point. The access is not available for everyone. And sometimes, you know, I know for myself, I'll get a couple of you know, when they, especially over COVID, streaming things, this, fine, that's $6 a month, fine, I'll do that. And then before you know it, it's like, wait a minute. I'm doubling up on live. Wait a second. What? How much money? Let me just go through and see exactly who I'm paying to what, and what am I getting from this, right? So, it's not like projects are specifically going to specific streamers, streaming channels. It's just if you have a script and a show, who's going to buy it? Who wants to tell that story with you? And if you get that yes, you gotta go for it, because it is a brutal business. It took Steven Spielberg 10 years to make Lincoln. That's Steven Spielberg. He had somebody else cast and something happened and then blah, 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 blah. And then it all worked out fine, But this stuff takes time, trust me, and it's not easy. And if you get to sell something, you know, to get it made, first of all, it's almost a miracle that things end up on the air.
Yeah.
It's a miracle. I understand not everybody can afford it. Maybe choose one of your just find out what has trial. I shouldn't be saying this, but choose one, stick with it. Then get another one and see the new shows that you want to see. Then cancel that subscription and go to another one.
Tammy?
People do that all the time.
They do it all the time.
Right? Yeah. But I think I can address part of the shows like First Lady and Veep, and these shows are much more expensive than even the whole idea of everything has to be accurate. We talked about White House Plumbers or Veep. They had to rebuild those sets. And all of this is very, very expensive. So that's why premium channels tend to do it. And even when Netflix started, if you remember when Netflix started, what did they start with? House of Cards, because they knew that a political show was the most powerful way to come in. But I'll tell you, we haven't talked about it, and I don't want to end on a doom and gloom, but if you look at primetime broadcast TV now, there's no way ER would ever exist. Because the companies are taking their money and putting it into the streaming channels. For the broadcast channels, you know, there's game shows in primetime, and CBS still have a lot of dramas, but all those shows are much more expensive. Mm-hmm. So the sense is, if you're putting all this money into streaming, you're not putting it into the broadcast channels. So why, you know, will they exist in the same way? Will you be a network affiliate if you're an NBC affiliate, right? The reason you affiliate is because you want NBC News, you want NBC primetime programming, you want the Today Show, you want this and that. There are certain, you know, marker type things. If there's no ER, right? And I love Jane Lynch and I love those game shows, but is that gonna carry? If you look at the numbers, that's one of the big things, which makes what you said about like pick your channel and try it and then cancel and go to the next thing. The problem also is everyone's looking at their stock price now, and so they're just cutting back on the amount of original programming. Netflix, I mean, it's remarkable what they've achieved in building programming, but it's definitely not, at least for the next year.
I have to say, though, I'd been wanting to bring Jeannie Boulet back. I did. I wanted to bring her back 20 years later. Her viral count is zero. She's living in New York. I had a whole thing. We'll see what happens. I'm just kidding, but I would have gotten the viewers, I think.
Yeah.
I would hunt you down and make sure you'd be watching the show. No, I'm just kidding. But no, those are good points, indeed. Very true.
I think we are... Okay, we'll do last question.
Hello. My question is, do you think that movies like White House Down and Air Force One, where the president is in trouble, portray the presidency or the White House or America in a negative light to Americans or around the world?
We talked a little bit about so the vulnerability that we're now seeing in the narrative portrayal of the presidency in movies like White House Down. But you also saw this in movies like Air Force One, and this goes to some degree, not only the vulnerability of the presidency, but also a heroicness about the presidency that's often sort of where we want to think about that space and the person in it. And so a narrative that casts this heroic individual and this office as vulnerable or in a way compromised is also a really good story. And so I think that combined with some of the conspiracy theories that we have, you know, sort of in the zeitgeist these days is where we see some of this sort of coming through in portrayals of the presidency and the president, him or herself.
Yeah, we didn't even really get to talk about it much, but I always, when I was a kid, I remember seeing Independence Day.
Mm-hmm. Oh, the best.
And, right. You know, you see the part where the aliens blow up the White House.
Right.
And it's pretty jarring, but like, you know, as a kid, you're like, wow, that was cool. Probably not,
aliens.
Not supposed to say that now.
Yeah.
Because we're supposed to preserve the White House, but, you know. But I mean, sci-fi is another whole genre that we didn't really get to touch on a whole lot. But it's interesting, that idea of vulnerability, because it's almost sort of like, here's the most powerful person in the world, but they're sort of like, help, I need superheroes to help. I mean, that was something else we saw this morning with the morning panel.
I'm totally interrupting you, forgive
Go
me.
Go for it.
But what about, this is, okay, the best White House movie, comedy, sci-fi, Mars Attacks.
Yep.
Right.
Yep.
Yeah. Remember?
Yep.
Yep.
So Jack Nicholson.
So funny.
I mean, that was a pretty star-studded cast.
Yeah, it was.
So yeah. Well, we've gone over time, but I want to thank our panelists for this exciting conversation. We're gonna take a short break before our final conversation of the day. So we'll be back in about 10 or 15 minutes.